Let's go back to James chapter 4. And I started with these verses last night. If you missed last night, I used a lot of scriptures. And the reason I did that was to just try and overwhelm people with the fact that the pride, the arrogancy, the independence, the self-centeredness that is so prevalent in our society today is completely against the Word of God. And these are the scriptures that I started with in James chapter 4. And in verse 6, it says, "But he giveth more grace." And so the title of this series that I'm doing is Humility, God's Path to More Grace. "He giveth more grace, wherefore he saith, God resisteth the proud, but giveth grace unto the humble. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw nigh to God, and he will draw nigh to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded." And then also, let me just turn over and read quickly in 1 Peter chapter 5. This is basically the same thing by a different author, but it's the same Holy Spirit. And in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 5, it says, "Likewise, ye younger, submit yourselves unto the elder. Yea, all of you be subject one to another, and be clothed with humility, for God resisteth the proud and giveth grace to the humble. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time, casting all your care upon him, for he careth for you." And we talked about this and just a lot of other scriptures, but basically I was just trying to get across that humility is the way that God is. You know, in Matthew chapter 11, I believe it's verse 29 or 39, I don't have that in front of me right now, but it said, Jesus was speaking, and he said, "Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest unto your souls." God is meek. Well, that just doesn't even seem to go in the same category as the word God. When you think of God, you think of almighty and all-powerful and does whatever he wants, but God is a meek God. That's amazing to me. And Jesus was God manifest in the flesh. He's meek. And the scripture says, how can two walk together except they be agreed? We are not going to really have the closeness and the intimacy with God that we desire to have unless we learn humility. And you put this together with those other verses that God resists the proud. Another verse that I used last night was Psalms 138, verse 6, where it says that he knows the proud afar off. You put that together with James chapter 4, verse 8, where it says, draw nigh to God and he'll draw nigh to you. There's no way that you can get really close to God and have the intimacy and the benefit that he wants you to have as long as you are operating in pride. And sad to say, our world today promotes pride, embraces it, celebrates pride. And I used a lot of scriptures last night that God hates pride. So let me just use a few scriptures here and first of all talk about what pride, or let me say what humility is not. Religion, when it does teach on humility and it teaches against pride, it, I believe, has distorted it to where religion teaches that humility is thinking bad of yourself. And that is not what humility is. That's wrong. Let me use some scriptures here. In Philippians chapter 2, verse 3, it says, "Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, but in lowliness of mind let each esteem others better than themselves." Again, this has been twisted to where we're supposed to just think terrible of ourselves. This isn't saying you think terrible of yourselves. It's just saying you think even better of other people. You know, the scripture that I quoted last night, Leviticus chapter 19, verse 18, it says you shall love your neighbor as yourself. If you hate yourself, well, then that does no good to love your neighbor as yourself. You aren't supposed to hate yourself. And yet, sometimes religion has taught that humility is just a hatred for yourself and a loathing of yourself. And because of this, religion has messed up a lot of people. You know, my sister just died this last week, and we had a memorial service for her, and she was a great woman. She led hundreds of people to the Lord. I didn't even know all the things that she did, but she went into a prison every week for 35 years. And there were literally hundreds of people's lives who were changed. She was a school teacher, and she affected a lot of people. And anyway, a lot of great things. But after the memorial service, we went out to eat, and I was talking to her daughter, and her daughter was talking to her this summer and saying something about, "Mom, you need to start confessing God's word over you." And she says, "Well, which scripture?" And my sister, she listened to me. She knew everything that I knew. She knew the word, but she had trouble applying it sometimes in her life. And her daughter was saying, "You need to start confessing how much God loves you." And so she says, "Well, give me some scriptures." So she gave her a lot of scriptures about, you know, how that you are the apple of his eye, how that God rejoices over you and all of these things, and says, "You start confessing these scriptures." And my sister Joyce just broke down and cried and said, "I just can't do it." She just couldn't say that. And anyway, as I was talking to my niece and she was relating all of these things to me, I could understand why. Our family, we were brought up with a condemnation and a unworthiness mentality. And it was under the guise of being humble, but it actually was just condemnation. And religion taught us this, that, you know, you just think the worst of yourself. And my sister, I really believe that that was one of the things that caused her to die at 75. She died younger than she should have. And it's just this condemnation. And many people have been taught that this is a God thing. But it didn't say that you're supposed to think bad of yourself. It's just saying that you ought to esteem other people better than yourselves. It doesn't mean that you have a bad image of yourself. Another verse that goes along with that is Romans chapter 12 and verse 3. Let me turn over and read this to you. Romans chapter 12 verses 1 and 2 are the verses that the Lord used to literally change my life. That's 1967. These are the verses that came alive to me. And in verse 3, it says, "For I say through the grace given unto me to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, according as God hath dealt to every man the measure of faith." Again, this doesn't say that you're supposed to think that you're the scum of the earth. It just says you aren't supposed to think more highly than you ought to think. So let me say it this way. Humility is just having God's opinion about you and not an inflated opinion or a deflated opinion. Basically, religion has said you can't knock yourself down low enough. You can't think bad enough about yourself. That's humility. But you go one inch above what's right about you, and boy, that is pride. And that's wrong. You know, humility is just being in the center. It's having God's opinion about you, not going above it or below it. And if you debase yourself and think bad about yourself, that's not humility. It's still arrogance. It's still, well, let me rephrase that. It's probably not arrogance the right word, but it's pride. You're still focused on self. Humility in its simplest terms, I believe, is just not being self-centered, not having an opinion about yourself, not really even caring one way or the other. You have died to yourself, is what the scripture talked about. Last night we used those verses out of Matthew chapter 16 about, "If any man will follow me," Jesus was speaking, you have to deny yourself. Not debase it, not say something about it that's not true, but just get to where you are not living for yourself. You put God and other people first. And this is really important that you get this point, because religion has misrepresented true humility. You know, I heard a story one time about a church that took a vote to see who the most humble person in the entire church was. And everybody agreed that it was dear old brother so-and-so. He was the most humble person in the whole church. And so on Sunday morning, they called him up front, and they had this huge button that was like this big that was red with white letters on it, "Humble." And they gave him this humble button. And because he accepted it, they took it away. that if he would have really been humble, he would have said, oh no, I don't deserve it. Look over here in Numbers chapter 12. In Numbers chapter 12 is where Miriam and Aaron came against Moses and criticized him because he married an Ethiopian woman. An Ethiopian woman was dark-skinned, and Moses was like a Middle East light-skinned person. So it was an interracial marriage, and they criticized him, and they wanted to take over some of the leadership of the nation because of this interracial marriage. And so when this happened, it's in Numbers chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, is where it talks about their criticism of him. In verse 2, they said, "Hath the Lord indeed spoken only by Moses? Hath he not spoken also by us? And the Lord heard it." And look in verse 3, in parentheses, it says, "Now the man Moses was very meek above all the men which are upon the face of the earth." Man, that is one huge statement. We know that there were millions that came out of Egypt, the Jews that came out of Egypt, and they were the minority in Egypt. And so there was multiple millions in Egypt and then the land of Canaan over all of the earth. We don't know, but there was at least 10 million, 20 million, who knows how many millions of people on the earth. And Moses was the meekest man on the face of the earth. And what makes this even greater is Moses is the one that wrote this. That is significant. Let me just ask you, we got, 800 people or whatever in here this morning. There's got to be somebody in here that's more meek, more humble than anybody else. What if I was to say, let's everybody bow our heads and pray, and we're going to ask God to reveal who the meekest person in here is. And if God tells you that you're the meekest person, you stand up and tell us. If we were to do that, how many of you would be meek enough to stand up and say, it's me? If a person would say, well, it may be me, but what would people think if I did that? Then you aren't truly meek. True meekness, true humility is not debasing yourself. It's just not promoting yourself. It's not having an opinion about yourself. And if God spoke to you under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit and said, you are the meekest person on the face of the earth, it would be pride on your part not to say that. Amen. Again, this is something that most people don't think, but you know, when the Bible says that we are now the righteousness of God, religion has taught people, oh, there's nothing good in me and I'm just the scum of the earth. And religion has basically debased people to the point that you feel I am nothing, I have nothing, I can do nothing. And religion has said, that's awesome. And so when you come along and start saying you're the righteousness of God, that man, you're the apple of God's eye, that God loves you. Religious people can't even say that. They can't even admit that. And you know what that is? That's pride. You are exalting your own opinion. You do not want people to think something of you, so you won't speak the truth, even though you know it to be true. That's pride. A truly humble person is a person that just doesn't really have an opinion one way or the other. They aren't going to promote themselves, but they aren't going to debase themselves. If God says you go lay hands on the sick and they shall recover, they say, yes, sir. And they go do it. And they tell them, says, I've got the power to heal you right now. And you know, there's some people in here, I'm sure, that just right now you say, oh, I'd never say that. That's wrong to say that you have the power. See, religion comes along and says, oh God, we are nothing, we have nothing, we can do nothing, but we know that you can do all things. Would you please stretch forth your hand to heal? That is a religious prayer. In Acts chapter 3, Peter and John were going into the temple at the hour of prayer, and they saw this man begging for food, and they said, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have, give I unto thee. And they didn't even pray and ask God to heal him. They just said, rise up and walk. And they grabbed him by the hand and jerked him up, and his feet and ankle bones received strength, and he went walking and leaping and praising God. Did you know that would get him kicked out of nearly any church in America today to say, I have the power? But the Bible says you do have the power. In Matthew chapter 10, he said, you heal the sick, cleanse the lepers, raise the dead. For you to say, I can't heal anybody, you're wrong. Now, if for some reason you were talking about you without God, well, then you would be correct. But the truth is, you know, it does say in John chapter 15, verse 5, for without me, you can do nothing. That's Jesus that said that. And that is an absolutely true statement. But the truth is, you're never without Jesus. And for you just to say, oh, I couldn't heal anybody. I can't heal a gnat. That's wrong. Unless somehow or another you're divorcing yourself from Jesus. He's always with you. And the truth is that you are the one that has been given the supernatural healing power of God. The reason people aren't being healed today is because there are so many people who are saying, I can do nothing, I have nothing. Oh God, would you heal? He didn't tell us to pray and ask Him to heal people. He told you to go heal the sick, raise the dead, cast out devils. It's a command. Matthew chapter 10, verse 8, Luke chapter 9 also says it. We were commanded to go heal the sick, and it's this false humility that I have nothing and I can do nothing that has made us to where we say, oh God, would you please heal him? And God's yelling at us and saying, you heal him with the power that I put on the inside of you. I gave you power and authority. Use it. False humility will keep a person from operating in the supernatural power of God. It'll keep you from taking your authority. It'll make you feel inferior to sickness and disease when the truth is, in the flesh, in just your natural, Paul did say this in Romans chapter 7, I know that in me, parentheses, that is in my flesh, dwells no good thing. That's true. But I am not just me. I am wall-to-wall Holy Ghost right down here. Man, I've got the power of God living on the inside of me. And it is not arrogance to sit there and acknowledge who you are in Christ and what God has given you. I'll teach on this more in another session this weekend. But the real rub here is who gets the credit? If you take the credit, man, look, I prayed for this person. I healed this person. It was my power. It was my anointing. That's pride. But if you sit there and say, I prayed for them and use the authority that Jesus gave me, all glory goes to Jesus, but it flowed through me. That's not pride. It just depends on who you give the glory to. God said He would not share His glory with another person. And if you were taking credit for things, that's wrong. But it's also wrong for you to deny and not acknowledge the good things that God has placed on the inside of you. If God has worked a miracle on the inside of you, it's humility for you to say, I'm the meekest man on the face of the earth. It would have been pride on Moses' part for him not to acknowledge that. If the Holy Spirit had inspired him to write that and he wouldn't acknowledge it because he's going to think, what are people going to think of me? That would have been pride. Amen. Did you know for me, because I was brought up under all of this condemnation and made to think that I'm lower than everybody else and stuff like this, did you know for me, it is humility for me to acknowledge good things. It's not my natural thing to do that. And for me to sit here and acknowledge that, God, you have done things in my life and you have used me and there are good things. That's humility for me to do it. Everybody get that? So we need to redefine what humility is. Humility, in my opinion, is just having God's opinion about you, not thinking of yourself more highly than you should, but also not thinking more lowly than you should, esteeming other people better than yourself. You know, the way that the Lord really changed my life, I got born again when I was 8 years old, the very first time that God ever nailed me over sin. Not the first time I ever sinned, but the first time I ever knew that I sinned against God, not just against my parents. Man, I repented and I got born again the very next day. And so I got born again when I was 8 years old, but then I went to church and I became religious and I got to really, you know, thinking that you had to earn God's favor. And so I did everything that they told me to do. You know, I'm turning 67 pretty soon, and I've never said a word of profanity in my whole life. I've never smoked a cigarette. I've never taken a drink of liquor. I've never even tasted coffee. in all of my nearly 67 years. I've lived a holy life. And I got really proud of me living a holy life. I know some of you are thinking, coffee? I'm not against coffee. I'm just saying I never drank it. I don't even know why. I just never have had any coffee. I figured, why start now? You got a scripture to stand on for drinking coffee. Mark 16:18 says you can drink any deadly thing and it shall not harm you, amen. So go ahead and drink your coffee. I'm just saying, I've lived a super holy life, but I got really proud of my holiness. And I got to thinking I was better than other people because I've never done these things. And I got to looking down my nose at people. And on March the 23rd, 1968, it's a long story, but God showed up in a prayer meeting. It was at midnight. And this is what I did with my friends. As an 18-year-old, we would get together and pray for a couple of hours every Saturday night. That's what we did for fun, and have a prayer meeting. And in this prayer meeting, God showed up. And in front of the leaders of the church, all of the adults that were leaders of the church, as well as my friends, God just showed up, and I don't have the words to describe this, but when I saw the glory of God, it's like God pulled back a curtain, and I just saw God, not with my physical eyes, but God was in that room. And I mean, everybody in that room knew God was there. Man, fear hit all of us. And we saw the glory of God. And when I saw the glory of God, my relative worth was pretty poor. And I immediately recognized that all of my righteousness, all of my self-goodness was like filthy rags, Isaiah 64:6. And man, I repented. And in front of all of the leaders of the church and in front of all of my friends, I started confessing all of my sin. I was told that God's the one that killed my dad when I was 12 years old, and that God judged us and did things. And so when I saw the glory of God and realized how far short of what I was supposed to be, I was, man, I thought God was going to kill me. I was afraid that I was going to die. I expected God to kill me right then, because when I saw my unholiness through His eyes, man, it was the first time I'd seen it, and I figured it was the first time God had seen it. I just figured He was going to kill me. So I started confessing everything I had ever done, and I hadn't done that much. I'd lived a relatively holy life, but the scripture says if you think it in your heart, you're guilty of it. So every thought of lust that I ever had, I confessed it. Every time I ever hated a person, which the Bible says if you hate a person, it's the same as murder, I confessed all of that. I confessed everything I had ever done or thought, and confessed everything I would ever do, just to make sure that everything was covered, so that if God killed me, I hopefully would go to heaven instead of to hell. And to my surprise, after an hour and a half of turning myself inside out and just repenting of everything I could possibly think of, and I was just laying in a puddle on the floor, I didn't have anything else left to say. Instead of judgment and punishment, man, this supernatural love of God flowed through me. I can't even describe it to you, but for 4.5 months, I was just caught up in the love of God. I knew that God loved me. I don't even know how I knew it, but I just had a supernatural love poured over me. Charles Finney described it as waves of liquid love flowing over him. And Dwight L. Moody described it in a similar type of way. And I had an experience like that. And God just poured His love out on me. And it was wonderful, but it was really confusing. Because I was always thinking that you had to be good enough to earn God's love. And for the first time in my life, I realized that there wasn't any good thing in me. And I had come face to face with all of my inadequacy. You know, now in hindsight, what happened was I humbled myself. People who are trusting their goodness and promoting their goodness and talking about that, man, I've done this and now I'm holy enough. I fast, I pray, I do this, and now God, you owe it to me. You've got to move. Most people wouldn't describe it this way, but you know what that is pride. You are trusting in yourself. You are thinking that somehow or another you are worthy of God using you. And God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. God resists legalistic Christians who trust in themselves and are trying to push the buttons to make God do something. Man, that does not get the results that you desire. You know, I'll make a statement here that some of you may choke on this, but sin doesn't bother God. He's already paid for sin. Your ungodliness isn't stopping God. You know what is stopping God is your pride, your dependence upon yourself, your promotion of yourself, your thinking that you're awesome and that somehow or another God owes you something. That will stop the power of God from operating in your life. God resists the proud, but He gives grace to the humble. And when I humbled myself that night, I mean all of this love and grace and mercy just poured out in my life. It was absolutely awesome. And I have spent the last 47 years trying to figure out who God is and trying to figure out how could a holy God love an unholy me. And anyway, this teaching that I have on spirit, soul, and body answers those questions. I'm going to share some characteristics of pride with you, and this may go completely against a lot of the stuff that you've thought. But here's one: independence from God, doing things independent of God, or you could say not being God dependent, is pride. And I would venture to say that every person in here was raised to be independent of God. Even if you were raised in a Christian home and told about God, basically most people believe God helps those who help themselves, that you do everything you can on your own and you use God when it goes beyond your ability. And if it gets beyond your ability, then you cry out to God for help. But that is not so. We should be absolutely dependent. You know, in the 33rd chapter of Exodus, is where Moses had this relationship with God. He was speaking to God. He spent 40 days and 40 nights fasting, no food or water. You can't go more than 7 days. The average person can't go more than 7 days without dying, without water. He went 40 days without water or food, and then went down, broke the tablets, and turned around and went right back up to the mountain and went another 40 days without food or water. He went 80 days with no food or water. And he was in the presence of the Lord. And in the 33rd chapter, he began to plead with God, "God, show me your glory." And God spoke this to him. And he says, "I will go with you and I will be with you and lead you in the way that you should go." And Moses' response to that was, he says, "Lord, if you don't go with us, I'm not moving." And it goes on that finally God did show him his glory. But the point I'm getting at is Moses was so dependent upon God that he says, "God, if you don't go with me, I'm not moving." How many people in here that's our attitude? And again, I think you're the cream of the crop. This is a Friday morning. Man, you aren't the nod to God Sunday crowd. So I'm not criticizing you, but I bet you out of this group of people, I would venture to say that the majority of people, you are well capable of doing things on your own, and you only come to God when you get into trouble, when something doesn't work. Let me ask you, when do you pray the most? When do you study the Word the most? When things aren't working, when your back's against the wall. That's the way that the average Christian lives. You know what you could say there? That's independence from God. You only use God when when it goes beyond your ability. If we would get to a place to where we depended upon God constantly for everything and got to the same point that Moses did, that God, I'm not moving. If you don't go with me, you wouldn't have the problems that you've got. You wouldn't make the wrong decisions. You wouldn't have the train wrecks and the problems that we have if we were absolutely dependent upon God. You know, last night I shared this out of Isaiah chapter 14, where Satan's original sin was pride, rebellious against God. Isaiah chapter 14, verses 13 and 14, he says, "I will ascend unto the sides of the north. I will sit on the throne of God. I will be like the Most High God." Satan's sin was pride, independence from God. He didn't want to be the anointed cherub, is what it calls him over in Ezekiel 28. It calls him the anointed cherub that covers. He was one of the highest ranking angels in heaven, and that wasn't enough. He wanted more. He wanted it all for himself. His sin was pride. And so pride is the thing that started all of this, and we have to get rid of that. Satan used this exact same thing against Adam and Eve. When he came to Adam and Eve, they had trusted God. God is one that created them. He made a perfect environment. The atmosphere was perfect. The food was there. Did you realize that they didn't have to wait until they had a need and say, God, I'm hungry. And God said, oh, I didn't think of that. Here's some food. They didn't have to say, God, I need air to breathe. And he says, oh, I'll create air. No, God anticipated everything that they could ever had. He created everything before they ever had a need. Everything was provided. And they were absolutely dependent upon God. They fellowshiped with God every day in the cool of the evening. And the temptation that came against Adam and Eve in Genesis chapter 3 was a temptation that, you know what, you don't need God. God's holding you back. You could be better on your own. Exalt your own opinion. Do things your own way. That's what the serpent told them. So they looked at the tree and they used their own reasoning, and they saw that the tree was pleasant to the eyes, a tree to be desired to make one wise. And they took out and they acted independent of God's instructions. You'll hear some people today say, well, God, you know, he just doesn't want anybody to have any fun. He's kept all of these things from us. God has never told us to do anything for our hurt. Every command of God is for our own good. And yet people today think, no, God is just trying to restrict me. No, God's trying to bless you. You know, in Psalms chapter 34, I believe it's verse 12, it says that if you keep the word of God, it'll lengthen your days and add life to you. Today, I was talking to a woman who's dealing with some cancer, and she's into all of the naturalistic health type things. And there's okay. There's a balance in all of this. I'm not against all of that. But I am against people who put their trust in these natural things. If you listen to the health experts today, they will sit there and tell you all these physical, natural things. It's just humanistic. It's independent of God. They don't factor God into the equation. And yet the Bible says, would you put up there Psalms chapter 34, I believe it's verse 12. And it says, what man is he that desires life and loves many days that he may see good? What's the next verse? Keep thy tongue from evil and thy lips from speaking guile. So this is talking about loving length of days and seeing good. How do you do it? By keeping your tongue from evil and guile and doing God's word. Did you know spiritual things are much more important to our health and benefit, mental benefit, than just natural things? You know, they do these surveys. They go over to Japan and they find that those people have the lowest level of heart disease in the world. And so the first thing they do is look at their diet. And so they eat a lot of fish and they have a lot of omega-3 oils in their diet. And so they come up with, that's the key to not having heart problems. And they don't even factor into it that the Bible says, honor your father and mother that your days may be long upon the land. And the Japanese, you talk about honoring the elder. They take it to such an extreme that they actually worship ancestors. The typical Japanese person will build a house in the backyard or on their property for their parents, and they honor them. But see, they never take that into account. They're just looking for some humanistic, some natural, organic thing that's the key to everything. This is only andiology. I can't find a scripture, but if I had time, I could, you know, quote Proverbs 15 or 22, I think it is, a merry heart does good like a medicine, and on and on and on. I could show you that spiritual, emotional things are much more important to your health than these physical things. So andiology is that I think maybe 20% or a maximum of 30% of your health is dependent upon what you eat and exercise. And I'd say that 70 to 80% of your health is dependent on whether you have a merry heart whether you are honoring your parents, whether you're obeying the Word of God, whether you have cast your care over on the Lord. Spiritual, emotional things are much more important, but you won't hear people talk about that because we live in a society that is independent of God. They are trying to find the secret to health apart from God. They're trying to find joy and peace apart from God. I'm telling you, one of the definitions, one of the ways of looking at pride is anything that separates you from God and makes you dependent upon yourself and makes you dependent upon just human, natural ability. That's pride. Humility is being dependent upon God. Satan quit depending upon God and submitting unto Him and chose his own way. And that's where the original sin happened. Adam and Eve wound up choosing to obey the serpent and leaning unto their own understanding. And that's where sin and death entered into all of that. And all of this comes through the same thing. We have to learn to be dependent upon God. Look at this verse in Psalms chapter 10, verse 4. This is an amazing passage of scripture. You might ought to look this up in your Bible and mark this. You wouldn't believe this is there if you don't read it. The wicked, through the pride of his countenance, will not seek after God. God is not in all his thoughts. Pride is what keeps people from seeking after God. Pride is what keeps people from having God in all of their thoughts. Most people wouldn't have said that, but that's what the Bible says. Pride is what keeps us from seeking the Lord. And again, why is it that most people seek the Lord when their back is against the wall, when they've been told that they're going to die of cancer, when their finances have failed, when their marriage is failing? I had a number of people come talk to me last night and today who told me that it's only been the last few months that they've been listening, and now they're listening to everything I've got because they had a husband leave, because they had an evil report that they're going to die. When they get into trouble, all of a sudden people are humbled by life, by circumstances, and now they're serious and they're looking for somebody else who's bigger than them, and all of a sudden they're seeking God with their whole heart. It's pride that causes us to think, well, everything's fine. I don't have any problems. I can do whatever I want to. Just independence from God is pride. You know, in Jeremiah chapter 10, verse 23, let me turn over and read this to you. In Jeremiah chapter 10 is where God is speaking to the Israelites and pronouncing judgment on them because they had forsaken his covenant. And Jeremiah is recording the terrible things that are going to happen. And he talks about that the conquerors would come in and literally destroy everything, kill every person, take the pregnant women and rip them up and take their babies out and kill their babies. And it's just terrible, the things that are happening. And right in the midst of pronouncing this judgment, Jeremiah says, how could this happen to the people who were once the apple of God's eye? The people who were more favored than any other group of people on the planet. How could they fall from such a place to where they're just being devastated? And then he answers his own question in Jeremiah chapter 10 and in verse 23. And here's the answer. He says, O Lord, I know that the way of man is not in himself. It is not in man that walketh to direct his steps. You know how that happened? You know how problems happen in our life? It's because the way of man is not in himself. God gave you the privilege. He's given you the authority that you can choose how your life goes. You are a totally free moral agent. God will not force you to do one single thing. Contrary to religious doctrine that teaches that God sovereignly makes everything happen, nothing happens but what it's God's will. That is not what the Word of God teaches. That is the worst doctrine, I believe, in the whole body of Christ, that God controls every single thing. God gave you a free will and you can choose, but the right choice is to say, God, I need you. And to take this and say, I know that the way of man is not in himself. I'm not smart enough to run my own life. I'm not wise enough to control my own thing. God, what do you want? And if you would submit yourself to God that way, that is humility. But when we get to the point that God, everything's awesome, you know, especially young people are tempted with this. The older you get, you go through life, your life tends to knock a lot of arrogance out of you. But you know, young people, they think, man, I'm strong, I'm healthy, everything's awesome. You hadn't dealt with death, you hadn't dealt with failure and stuff, but boy, you live long enough, you're gonna see some people die. You're gonna see some things happen. My dad died, my grandmother basically raised me until I was about 8 years old. She died when I was 8 years old. And so I started dealing with this from a young age. And then my dad died when I was 12, and on you could go. I just had my pastor, the one that preached a message that caused me to go ask my father, what about this? And I got born again that day, and this pastor that baptized me, he got to where he was watching me on television, and we reconnected, and we've been great friends. He just died yesterday afternoon. And you know what? You just deal with a lot of stuff. And the older you live, the more you realize that you aren't quite as awesome as you thought you were. You know, one of the best things that ever happened to me was in the beginning of my ministry, nobody would come to our church or anything. And so, to minister, I just went into jails. I went into nursing homes. And they'll let anybody go into a nursing home and minister. You don't have to be anointed or nothing. And I remember going in these nursing homes, and I remember this one woman particularly. She was a Methodist pastor's wife, and she had been they had pastored a church of over 1,000 people. And at one time, they were the movers and the shakers. Everybody just, you know, praised them and honored them. But here she was in her old age, and she still was a very dignified woman. She'd always get dressed up, always had her hair combed, but she would sit there in a wheelchair and just cry all day long about, I used to be somebody special. I used to be important. And now nobody ever came and saw this woman. I was the only person who would ever go see her. And I'd spend time talking to her. And you know what? It was good for me because I saw that this woman who at one time, man, just had everybody at her feet praising her. If nothing else, old age is going to catch up with us someday. And you are not going to be able to perform at the same level. And you know what? If you have lived a life of being independent of God, then you're going to be in a sad state, crashing and burning. But if you've lived a life dependent upon God, even in your old age, I remember going to see Oral Roberts just a couple of months before he died, and I was in his home. And Oral Roberts was getting around on a walker that Billy Graham bought him. Billy Graham bought him this walker, and he was really proud of it and talking about it. But you know what? Oral Roberts, just a couple of months before he died, was praying for people. He prayed over Jamie and me and laid hands on us. And he prayed over people. And I mean, he was operating in the gifts of the Holy Ghost and ministering to people with his last breath. And he went out because he had been dependent upon God. I'm telling you, you don't have to be this arrogant person to be operating in pride. Just be a person that only uses God when you have messed up and after you have exhausted all of your resources and stuff, and you just turn to God when there's no other alternative. And you know what that is pride. And this is the reason that you get yourself in such a mess, is because you didn't depend upon God. I'm preaching better than you're listening. And that'd have been a good place to say amen. This isn't necessarily all the popular things to say, and I know people don't like to think about all of this and stuff, but you know what? If you don't think about it now and change something and take some different action, well, then you're going to be one of those that crashes and burns at the end of your life. Right now is when we need to confront all of these kind of things. So in Genesis chapter 3, that's where Adam and Eve, they operated independent of God, and that's where sin entered in. I've already quoted this verse, Matthew 11:29, take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly of heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. You know what? Jesus was meek. And look at some of the things that Jesus said. This is important that you get this. If anybody could have ever operated independent of God, it would have been Jesus, because he was God. He was sinless. And yet, he was so dependent upon God, he said, I can't do anything without him. Look at this in John chapter 5, verse 19. Then answered Jesus and said unto them, Verily, verily, I say unto you, the Son can do nothing of himself, but what he seeth the Father do. For what things soever he doeth, these also doeth the Son likewise. I've heard some people take that and try and twist it and say that Jesus wasn't God because he said he couldn't do anything without God. That's not a statement of him being less than God. Just the opposite, it's a statement of him saying that he was so one with his Father that he could not operate independent of him. He couldn't think or do anything. They were one. It's a statement of his divinity. If Jesus, who was God in the flesh and almighty and had no sin, if anybody ever had the option of operating independent of God, it would have been Jesus. But if Jesus was this dependent upon his Father, how in the world can we sit here and do our own thing and only turn to God when we're in desperate need? That's pride. Independence from God, doing it your way, is pride. And God knows the proud afar off. God resists the proud. You don't want that in your life. In John chapter 5, verse 30, he went on to say in that same chapter, he says, I can of mine own self do nothing. As I hear, I judge, and my judgment is just, because I seek not my own will, but the will of the Father which has sent me. Jesus could not, you could say would not, but he could not operate independent of God. And the very fact that we can operate independent of God is what gets us into trouble. You know, I'm not saying this for the purpose of condemnation, but I've done a lot of marriage seminars. We ask people, you know, give a testimony how you got together. And I remember one marriage seminar that Jamie and I did. There were 40 couples there. And out of 40 couples, there was Jamie and me and one other couple that even remotely had God involved in them getting together. All of the others, it was like I got drunk and woke up in the morning and here was this person and I saw this woman and man, I just had to have her, and he got her, you know, drunk. And I mean, that's the way that it went. And I'm not meaning to condemn anybody, because many people didn't know the Lord back then and stuff. But I'm saying that, you know, the average Christian does not depend upon God for your mate. Man, we go out and it's just like going down the grocery aisle, and I like this and this and this. I heard a story. I'm not going to take time to tell this whole joke, but it's really a good joke. But it's a story about, you know, they had this department store 5 stories tall, and the women could go in there and select the husband. And on the first level was a husband that had a job. And you could stop and get a husband that has a job. And man, that's a good deal. But every floor, things got better. But if you went up, you could never come back down to the lower level. And so they had women walk in and they said, well, man, that's pretty good that he's got a job, but I wonder what's on the second floor. So they go up to the second floor. And they get up there and there was people that had a job and they were compassionate and were romantics. They thought, oh man, this is great. I wonder what's on the third floor. So they go up to the third floor. They had a job. They were romantics. They were kind and tender to the children and nurturing and all of that. And they say, man, that's great. I wonder what's on the next floor. They go up there and man, here is a man that has a job. He is romantic, he's kind, and he's good looking. And so they go up to the fifth floor, and there's nothing on the fifth floor. They say, you're looking for the perfect husband. He doesn't exist. So then the man goes into the department store where there's, you know, women. You can select a wife. And on the first floor, you got this gorgeous woman. Nobody's ever been to the second floor. That's pretty much how we select our mate is, man, you want Mr. Perfect. You want the football captain and the guy who's got the abs and the six-pack and, you know, the wavy black hair. And the guy chooses the homecoming queen, this beautiful woman, so that when he's walking down the street, you know, with her on his arm, everybody's jealous of him. Oh man, I wished I had her. What a trophy she is. But then after you're married a while, the guy starts losing hair, turns different color, costs more for a haircut because you have to pay a finder's fee. You get the chest or drawers disease where your chest is done dropped down into your drawers, amen. And all of a sudden, well, I've lost my love. You never did love. That wasn't God's love. It was all about, man, they make me look good. It was all selfish. It was all pride. I had a man come to me one time and his wife had had a car wreck and she was like a vegetable, a quadriplegic. And this guy told me, he says, I just couldn't live with a woman like that. She couldn't meet my needs. And he divorced her. And I tell you what, the spirit of slap wanted to come all over me. I'd have just loved to pummel that guy like, she can't meet your needs and so you just leave her? That's not love. That's lust. And there's the average person doesn't involve God in them getting married. You know, Jamie and I were engaged to be married before we ever held hands. God put us together. God told us separately that we were supposed to get married. And I mean, it was God that put us together. God is the one that brought Eve to Adam, Ruth to Boaz, yes, and Rebekah to Isaac. He's the one that did all of this. God will put people together. It says, whoever finds a wife finds a good thing and obtains favor of the Lord. And then in Psalms chapter 34, no good thing will the Lord withhold from them who seek Him. If you would seek God, God will supernaturally put you together with your mate. You know, this man, Bill Gothard, who taught on the basic youth conflicts, he had a diagram that was an isosceles triangle where you have a point up here and then it goes down equal sides. And he had God at the top of this triangle and then man and woman down here. And he said, most people, they come together like this and then they may start seeking God together. But the way to do it is the man would seek God, and if the woman would seek God, as you seek God, you will bump into the perfect mate for you. But most people just do things on their own way. Most people have a job that you let circumstances dictate to you what job you got. Maybe it was the family business. Maybe you just, you know, who knows? I teach a lot on how to find, follow, and fulfill God's will. I've got teaching on that. And I'll often give an invitation and ask, how many people know beyond any shadow of a doubt that what you're doing with your life is what God wants you to do? Or are you just letting circumstances, are you just going with the flow? You know, a dead fish can float downstream. But man, to go upstream, to go against the flow, you got to have some backbone to be able to do that. And I'll often ask, how many of you know beyond a shadow of a doubt that you're doing what God called you to do? And it's not unusual to have 80% of spirit-filled Christians stand up and say, I don't know, I'm just doing this because it just happened. They hope that they're serving God. But in a sense, you could say it, that they are living independent of God. They're doing their thing and asking God to bless it. Man, I learned a long time ago that if you will do what God tells you to do, God would be unjust to give you instructions and not be there to help you accomplish it. If you do what God tells you to do, you never have to ask God to bless it. Did you know I never pray over a meeting and ask God to touch people? I never pray over a meeting. Because I'm doing what God told me to do. He told me to open my mouth and He'd fill it, that He'd speak through me and stuff. And I'm like Moses, God, if you aren't leading me to do it, I'm not moving, I'm not going. But if God has led me to do this, I don't have to ask God's blessing on stuff. I don't have to ask God to show up and to touch people's lives. He wants to do it more than I want Him to do it. And all I've got to do is just follow Him, and there is automatically a blessing and favor and an anointing on doing what God called you to do. Some of you are giving life and your job and all of your relationships and everything 110%. But did God call you to do that? Is it God that put you together in the first place? Is it God that ordained these things, or are you doing your own thing and trying to get God to bless it? You're never going to see the fulfillment of God's blessing on your life with you doing your own thing. There is a satisfaction and a joy and a contentment that comes with knowing that you are exactly where God wants you to be, that you cannot get any other way. And you may be born again, spirit-filled, love God, asking God to use you, but are you doing what God called you to do? And if you aren't, there will always be an holy dissatisfaction on the inside of you. You know, I have a place in Charlotte, North Carolina, where Pastor Derry and Karen are from down here. And I've been going there, I think, for 26 years. And I have a partner that has a business there, and he has about 30, 40 employees. He's now sold the business, but used to. I used to go into his business every year, and he would tell the people, he says, the clock is running. You listen to this guy talk as long as he wants to talk. I'm paying you. And I would just minister to them and then pray with people and see all kinds of good things happen. And anyway, one year after I administered to the group, I went out into the front office, and there was a Oriental woman sitting there who wasn't back in the with the group. And I said, who are you? And she said, oh, I'm the new receptionist. They had me sit here and answer phones while everybody else was back there in the back. And she says, who are you? And so I told her what my name was. And she says, what do you do? And I said, I'm a minister. And boy, her eyes got big. And she says, for who? And I said, for the Lord Jesus Christ. And she says, you're the one. And I said, I'm the one what? And she told me that the night before she was a Buddhist, and she was going through her Buddhist ritual, whatever that is, and she was just dissatisfied. There was still an emptiness, even though she was a strict, faithful Buddhist. She wasn't full. And so anyway, she just stopped and she says, God, this can't be you. She says, I know that there is a God. I know that you exist, but I can't believe that this is you. She says, would you reveal yourself to me? Show me who you are. And she said that instantly there was this ball of light in front of her that was just pulsating and radiating light. And she heard a voice saying, tomorrow I'll send you a man who'll tell you who I am. And so she says, you're the man. And I said, I am the man. Amen. I got to lead that woman to the Lord, baptized in the Holy Ghost. It was awesome. But did you know what? When I went out and sat in my car, I couldn't even start the car. I was just sitting there praising God, thinking, man, was I in the right place at the right time? To know that God told her I'd be there and that God set this up. There is a satisfaction and a contentment that goes with being in the center of God's will that you can't get out there doing your own thing. I'm telling you, independence from God, doing your own thing, is pride. You've probably never looked at it that way, but that's what it is. It is dependent upon yourself. It is promoting yourself. It's having an inflated opinion of yourself. The way of man isn't in himself. God gave us the privilege to choose, but the right choice is to say, God, I can't make it on my own. If you don't go with me, I'm not moving. You know, this couple, the Murins that we were talking about that are helping us do these musicals and stuff, I was out to eat with Robert and Elizabeth this last week, and Elizabeth was raised in a Christian home, knew the Lord since she was a young girl, but she just knew that there had to be something more. And you know what she did for one solid week? She didn't leave her room. She stayed in her room when she was about 18 or 19 years old and says, God, I'm not moving until I know you. And anyway, it's a long story, but boy, God showed up. And I talked about for 4.5 months, I was caught up in this glory of God and I was just overwhelmed by the love of God. She lived that way for 2 years. 2 years, just overwhelmed. She was telling stories about she'd go to a movie thing. And she was just so in love with God that she went to this movie, and every seat in the movie theater was taken except the one next to her. And she knew that that was so that the Holy Spirit could sit there, and she sat there and held hands with the Holy Spirit throughout the whole movie. I know some of you think that's crazy, but that's the reason you got all your problems. Man, I just thought that was awesome. I could relate to that, maybe only for 4.5 months, but man, isn't that something? And you need to get to a place where, God, I'm not going to go on living the way that I am. As long as you can live an inferior life, you will. But when you reach a place to where I'm sick and tired of being sick and tired, and I'm not going to live this way, and God, I need you, I want you, I want to know your will for my life, I want to be empowered by you, I want to have my mind stayed upon you, like that scripture I use in Psalms 10, for the wicked, because of the pride of his countenance, won't seek after God. It's wicked, it's pride to not have God in all of our thoughts. The Lord said in Isaiah 26:3, the Lord will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed upon him because he trusteth in him. All of us want perfect peace, but not all of us want our mind stayed on God. Man, we'll go long periods of time watching rape, murder, killing, plundering, sexual content on TV and stuff, and we just fill ourselves with that. You're never going to have perfect peace thinking the way that this world thinks. That's not how it works. So Jesus is a great example of a person who just was totally dependent upon God, and it says he was meek and lowly of heart. Humility, meekness, is just being dependent upon God. God, I need you. I'm not smart enough to do anything on my own. And I know that there's some people right now, well, God expects you to use your head. Well, yeah, but you recognize that, God, you're the one that gave me these talents and abilities. I'm not saying that you deny that maybe some of you are just really good with math, some of you are really good with music, some of you are really good, but you need to recognize God as your source. Right. You know, I was listening to Keith Moore. I don't know how many of you know him, but Keith and I have become good friends. He's an awesome man, and he was teaching on this, and he said that he's the kind that when he was a little tiny kid, he could just talk to anybody. He was an extrovert. He gave an example when he was 4 or 5 years old doing a dance routine at school, and he just always has been a performer and stuff. He could always talk to people. I was just the opposite. I was an introvert and couldn't even look at a person and talk to him, and God's asked me to talk to millions and millions of people now. But he was just talking about how he could do all of this, and he came to these same conclusions that I'm talking about, that he wasn't recognizing how much God was the source of everything in his life. And so he began to start praying and saying, God, I want to realize you as my source. I want to recognize and realize how dependent I really am upon you. And he, on this teaching, said he didn't recommend anybody praying this way. But he prayed and he said, God, just show me how dependent on you I am. The next day he got up, and he was the one that ran the healing school at Rhema, and it was every day they had healing school, and he would always get up and sing and then preach, and he said he never even had to really prepare. He just knew the word and he could stand up and share it. Well, he got up the next day and he went into healing school, and he couldn't remember a scripture. He couldn't remember anything. It was like he had never ministered in his life. He was absolutely petrified. And then he says, well, at least I got the song service. I'll go ahead and lead the song service, and by the time I get through with that, maybe I'll know what to minister. He couldn't remember chords. He couldn't remember where to put his hands on the guitar. He couldn't sing. He couldn't do anything. And he literally panicked. He had to call somebody else and get them to take over healing school. And for 3 days, he was in this state. His wife thought that he had lost his mind and was thinking about having to go get some help. And after 3 days, all of a sudden, it's just like everything came back to him, and the Lord spoke to him, and he says, you wanted to know what you are without me? Amen. And I know some of you think, well, I'm so tired, I don't really need to depend upon the Lord. It's God that gave you your talent. You need to recognize that God could take it away. All God would have to do is just stir the chemicals in your brain just a tiny bit, and man, you'd be able to, you know, wet the stamps off the drool dripping off your chin. Amen. Whether you know it or not, God's the one that gave you everything you've got. And until you develop this dependency and say, God, you're the source of everything I've got, then you're operating in pride. You're operating in independence from God. And pride goes before destruction, a haughty spirit before fall. He knows the proud afar off. God resists the proud. One of the keys to finding more grace is just humbling yourself, becoming dependent, recognizing, God, you're the source. Any good thing that I've got, you're the one who's done it. And if we would do that and acknowledge it, I guarantee you that is one of the characteristics of true humility, is just being absolutely dependent. And then when something good does happen, then you say, it's God. God's the one who's blessed me. God's the one who's made all of this come to pass. That's humility. And I tell you, brothers and sisters, we need to humble ourselves under the mighty hand of God that He might lift us up in due time. Amen? Amen. Y'all receive that? Thank you, Jesus. Father, we do humble ourselves today. We do say that, Father, we're dependent upon You for our breath. Father, we don't make the air that we breathe. Father, we haven't caused all of these things. We haven't made ourselves grow. We can't add one cubit to our stature. Father, we just acknowledge, we humble ourselves right now and acknowledge that You're the source of everything. Any good thing in us, any talents, any abilities that we have, Father, You're the source of all of it. We give You the credit. And Father, we want to humble ourselves and draw near to You. Father, we want to know You closely, not afar off. Father, we want to have all of these spiritual dynamics working in us that produce health and long life instead of just looking to physical, natural things and not acknowledging You as the source of our health. Father, we just humble ourselves today. I lead people in prayer today, Father, who have been ignorant of this, that haven't been acknowledging You, that it might have been years since they said thank You for their life, for the privilege of living in this nation, for the freedoms that our forefathers brought us. Father, we just humble ourselves and we say thank You. We acknowledge that these things are gifts. We humble ourselves today. And Father, we believe that as we humble ourselves, that Your anointing begins to flow, that You give more grace to us, that You deliver us from the problems that we're facing because of our own decision. Father, we just humble ourselves and we exalt You. And as we do, Father, we believe that Your power is flowing to change circumstances, to change our situations. Thank You, Jesus. Praise God. Well, the Lord is speaking to me that there's many people here today who got revelation. God was showing you why there is dissatisfaction in your life. Because you're doing your thing and asking God to bless it. God's saying, what is His thing? You need to go and find out what God's will is. You need to get rid of your own agenda. Run up a white flag and just submit yourself and say, God, what is it that You want? This is answering people's questions. Thank You, Father. We receive it. And Father, we believe that You are just flowing among people, setting people free in here today. Thank You, Jesus. There are some of you that have looked to the natural things for health, and there's nothing wrong. There is a proper use of that. I'm not telling you to go do the wrong thing, but you have not put your focus on God. Your nutrition, your diet, your exercise are getting the glory, not God. You need to rebalance things. You need to get to where you are putting your faith in God. Thank You, Jesus. Like Charlie was singing this morning, our hope is in You alone. Father, we put our hope, all of our expectation is in You. Thank You, Jesus. And the Lord is speaking to me that there's somebody in here who's really at the top of your game right now. You're doing great. You are prosperous. All kinds of things are coming your way. But you've been depending upon yourself. And it's just a matter of time until self runs out of gas. If you would humble yourself right now and begin to give God the glory and begin to honor Him and worship Him, you could avoid crisis. But if you don't receive this word and you continue to just depend upon yourself, there's coming a day that, man, you'll crash and burn. These things will leave as quickly as they go. God is speaking to you right now that you just need to humble yourself and glorify God and give Him the credit for all of these good things. Thank you, Heavenly Father. We agree and receive it in Jesus' name. Amen.